Well, good evening and Merry Christmas. It's good to have the ones that we have with us in house today, and it's also great to have all of you joining us online. We're really excited to be with you on Christmas Eve, and we're really grateful that you joined us and we've joined you. Tonight we have a really great cause that we're raising funds towards, and we're going to take an offering up for Joe's Place. They're an incredible organization here in Moose Jaw. We've been partners with them for many years as a church, and they do really incredible stuff. And so I'll tell you how you can give, and then we're going to learn more about Joe's Place. You can go to our website if you want, hillcrestmj.com, and it'll list different ways that you can give. But if you are e-transfer is your main way to give, then I'll just tell you the email address you can use. So you can e-transfer any giving to giving@hillcrestmj.com. And all the money that we receive in giving tonight will go towards Joe's Place. The other way you can give is you can mail a check to the church, and that might be simpler for others to do as well. Of those of you who are in-house, we do have offering plates on the way out of the service, and you can give through that. But let's just take a moment, and let's just pray, and then we'll learn a bit more about Joe's Place. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this season of joy, this season of anticipation. And in our lives, it's something that we've been anticipating for quite a while now, and now it is here, this incredible season. And I pray that you would guide us in this season. I pray that this would be a time of gratitude, a time of intimacy with others and with you, and that this would be a blessed season in the life of people in Moose Jaw and the surrounding area, and anywhere that anyone's watching this from today. I pray you just really let them know that you are with them, that your presence is with them in their home or wherever they are when they watch this. We ask that all in the name of Jesus. Amen. All right, let's learn about Joe's Place.
For the last 25 years, Joe's Place has offered the youth of Moose Jaw a safe place to hang out without the negative impact of drugs or alcohol. Our mission at Joe's Place is to make a difference in Moose Jaw by helping youth reach their full and God-given potential. Well, that mission got a little trickier this year, didn't it? When this pandemic first started, we had to ask ourselves, was the youth's mental health and spiritual well-being worth all the extra work it was going to take to deliver our program safely and within the regulations? Well, the answer to that was an easy and resounding yes. So we've worked full-time since the beginning of the pandemic to offer youth hope in the midst of these trying times. So we immediately invented the Isolation Olympics, a schedule of online contests and competitions with some really great prizes. And we were super impressed with all the talented entries, photography and dance, music, fort building, and so much more. We delivered art kits and ukuleles to our youth, and we got to see some really amazing talent in those ways. We also had our Childhood Heroes on Main Street event, which was a huge success with cars lined up all the way down Main Street. We also got approval to run a mini D-Day paintball fundraiser. But throughout this time, I think one of the most important things we did was to set up a private Discord server to check up on our youth daily, and we have over 180 youth on that right now. And I was so proud of my staff and volunteers as they did their best to encourage youth who were starting to sound down and depressed. And believe me, there was a lot of that. Once Saskatchewan started to open, we moved to socially distanced outdoor adventures in our beautiful local parks. We had photography walks, fishing, hiking, biking, kayaking, canoeing, and we also went paintballing lots, did a beach day, and we even went horseback riding. On Tuesdays, we were able to meet in Crescent Park in socially distanced circles, thanks to Family Pizza, who donated individual pizzas all summer long. Now we're running highly supervised and highly sanitized indoor programs with youth socially distanced and pre-registered for one of our four weekly evening programs. We've got our Tuesday dinner and a movie, Wednesday work bee, and two weekend hangout nights with five different activity areas to sign up for. Well, obviously we had to cancel our traditional voltage, so we planned a mini voltage in the May Wilson Theater with a live band and a voltage movie. And we also had to cancel that. So now we're running a micro voltage in Joe's Place for the youth who worked on the voltage movie, and it should still be a pretty fun event. It's been a lot of hard work, sending in proposals to the appropriate authorities to ensure that we're running everything safely and within the guidelines. But all that hard work, totally worth it. Just to see the joy it brings to these youth as they have some source of hope in an often dreary week. With so many things canceled, we know that these youth just need something to look forward to in these dark times. and as Kyle's article in the newsletter says, a mom came up to him during his morning exercise session and said, I'm very thankful for Joe's Place. Everything fun that my child was able to do this summer was through Joe's Place. But even more than the fun and the joy and the temporary hope, we're so excited for these youth to comprehend the love and the eternal hope that comes from Jesus. Please pray with us that we can continue to be there for the youth of this city that have lost so much. It is truly our desire that in the midst of so much loss, they might actually find the most important thing they could ever find, peace and hope in the arms of a loving God. Please pray with us to that end, and thank you once again for all of your support.
Thank you. Christmas. Happy Christmas Eve to you all. We are so happy that you're here with us. I can see your smiling faces through the masks. I really can see those smiling faces. We've got some Christmas carols for you this evening. So why don't you stand up and sing with us? Different. Normally, we would be attending Christmas parties and Christmas concerts and all sorts of Christmas get-togethers where we would be singing carols together. So I do definitely miss all of those opportunities to sing those carols. A lot of opportunities, I suppose, we didn't get to do this Christmas. But one special thing we did get to do, we got to visit Bethlehem in Hope Has Come. Many of you here today, did you visit Bethlehem in Hope Has Come? Absolutely. It was absolutely beautiful. I believe 2,500 people from Mushan area got to visit Bethlehem this Christmas, and that's just so exciting. So that is something that we did get to do this Christmas season. In Luke 2, it says, "So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, in Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born. And she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them." Why don't you join us as we sing, "O Little Town of Bethlehem"?
And fear. Shepherds guard and angels sing.
precious promise, Son of God and Son of Man. Heaven's glory in a manger has come to us in Bethlehem.
Wow, incredible song. I want to just say a great big thank you to all of the musicians and technical people and the people, all the volunteers who've come to make this service a possibility tonight. This has just been amazing. The music and the ability to sing together, even through a mask, is still precious to us. It's still valuable to us. At this time, we're going to take up the offering, and if you're in the house, you can do that at the end of the service, but if you're online, again, there's different ways to do it. You can e-transfer to giving@hillcrestmj.com. If there's other ways you'd like to give, obviously you can mail a check, that's fine, but there's other ways to give. You can go to hillcrestmj.com and you can check those ways out now. But we're giving that offering again to Joe's Place Youth Center and the amazing work they do here in Moose Jaw and the impact that they're having on young people and students, their mental health through the season, and also offering them hope for years to come. So we're just really excited about what they're doing, and we want to partner with such an incredible organization. Now, this is a candlelight service, so at the end we are going to light some candles. So if you're joining us at home, I just really want to encourage you to find a candle, and if you can, and set it aside, at least one, maybe you've got more. I've got more than one today, I noticed, and I'm really excited about all the different candles we have up here. And of course, in our live audience here, you're going to be joining us with live candles at the end of the service as well. So when I was thinking about tonight, the question that was on my mind was this. What do people need right now? What do people need right now? And the answer that I've come up with is this. I think people need to be lifted. People need to be lifted. They need some joy in their lives. You know, if you look at any of the studies that are out in the last few years, and including this very unique year, you'll see that people are laughing less and carrying more. There's more depression, there's more anxiety, there's more need for medication in people's lives. These things are not going away, but they're significant in our society. And I really saw this a few weeks ago. 3 or 4 weeks ago, we had Brian Heaney from the Moose Jaw Christian Counseling Center come and speak for 2 weeks. And he was talking about loss and grief, and that if you don't grieve your losses, they lead to depression, and talked for 2 weeks. First week, he really just sort of laid out, we go to the wrong source to get life. We really need to be going to God with those things. And he laid that out the first week. And then the second week was full of illustrations and practical applications of how to go to God to get life. It was really good stuff. So I encourage you, if that's something that would help you, just go to our YouTube page. Just search Hillcrest Church in Moose Jaw. You'll find it. And then look for Good Grief. It's just 2 weeks, but it's really helpful. And why I'm talking about it right now is because people have been watching it and rewatching it because it's been personally helpful to them. And so I just want to make you aware of that, that this is something that's a big deal in our world. There's a gravity or a weightiness to people's lives. And it's in all of their life circumstances. It might be a weightiness or a gravity in their health. It might be in their finances. It might be in their work or the job pressures that they're facing right now. It might be in their family relationships. But I was thinking, what's the opposite of gravity? Well, one opposite of gravity is levity. Levity. And so levity, we often use that about laughter, right? Laughter. What lifts you? I was looking for a light moment earlier this week, and so I actually didn't have anyone with me. I was just sort of studying on my own, so I just quickly pulled up my phone and I said, Siri, tell me a joke. Do you know you could do that? Siri tells jokes. She's pretty smart about a lot of things, but I said, tell me a joke. I thought, oh, let's see how funny she is. This is the joke she told me. I think it's totally randomized. She said, how did Darth Vader know what Luke had got him for Christmas? And the answer is, because he felt his presence. Oh, okay, only Star Wars geeks will get it. But I thought, that's not bad for a computer or whatever, to give you a joke. So you can even get jokes from Siri. That's amazing. But people are looking for things that lift them. People are looking for environments that lift them, or activities that lift them, or people that lift them. They need some lifting. You know, I found that, for me, movies have an ability to lift me. And in this Christmas season, we've been watching a few movies, and often there's movies you'll watch with your younger kids, and there's movies you watch with your older kids. And I've got sort of a big gap between my two oldest and my two youngest. So my two older ones will often stay up a little later, and we'll watch a guy movie. And so we'll watch things with car chases and kung fu showdowns and sweeping battlefields, comeback sports teams, explosions and more explosions, gladiators and gangsters and axe-wielding dwarves and Beskar-wearing Mandalorians and gun-toting cowboys and all those things, including Scottish rebels. That's yet to come. What happens is that I see that it not only inspires me, but it inspires my sons. In fact, I could sort of see them being lifted as they watch these things. And I experience them being lifted because what happens is they're watching this testosterone-filled movies that are sort of talking about being a man and rising up. They tend to rise up. And sometimes in the middle of the movie, and attack me. They attack me. And they attack me, like, totally unprovoked. So I think it's just like they're feeling like, man, it's amazing being a man. And you know, as you know, I wonder if I have a chance at taking on the alpha dog in the house. You know, maybe this is my year. And so out of the blue. So I have to watch the movie with one eye and watch them with the other eye to make sure that I'm ready. You know, I've got a lot of Charlie horses on my legs. And there's a lot of couch cushions that I've had to clean up after they've been tossed around. And all of this has happened, and we haven't even watched Braveheart yet. So, you know what it's like. Now, I don't want to cause envy, especially because I'm a pastor. I don't want to cause envy. I know that some dads are raising girls, and so they've been watching Frozen on repeat through the snowstorms and everything. And so I pray for them. Pray for them. No, I'm just kidding. Girls are awesome, too. I have a 3-year-old girl, and what lifts us is a dance party. So we'll just get the phone and now for her, a dance party always has to start with Baby Shark. It can have other songs in it, but it has to begin with Baby Shark. That's the required. Now, I want to go to MC Hammer or something I'm a little more, you know, down with, but she wants to, you know, she wants to do Baby Shark. So we do a lot of dancing, just the two of us often. My wife will say, "You're in the front window of the home. All the neighbors can see you dancing." And I'm saying, "Well, they won't watch for long. If they're watching me, they'll turn away." But if they're watching my daughter, well, she's awful cute. But music can lift you. Christmas music especially lifts us. How many of you started playing Christmas music way earlier than the Christmas season? Or you know someone in your home, you want to just point at them right now because they're not admitting it. Okay, yeah, I could see that almost in most families. It's something. Christmas music is an amazing trend. I find what's fascinating to me is when rock stations start playing Christmas music. Because there's sort of this, like, you know, different stations have different... their identity, right? So you might have a light pop station, or then you have more of a hard rock station. And it's like the hard rock station, they wait the longest till they finally do Christmas songs. But eventually they do, because everyone gives in. In the end, everybody plays Christmas music. And so you have, like, if you're listening to a pop station, maybe you're listening to songs, and they're sort of like angsty revenge love songs or something. And then suddenly the next song is Christmas, upbeat. Lifting, you know, our hard rock station is, you know, just, you know, dirty and grimy and we're not going to take it. And then suddenly, boom, upbeat, Christmas. It's really quite a transformation. I always wonder what those DJs, how they, you know, manage the changes and when they decide to really invest in, let's put the upbeat music on. I want to, now in the 4 o'clock service, I introduced a song that I think is an upbeat Christmas song that just sort of grabs you. And I just read it, and then people told me afterwards, I wasn't familiar with that song. So I thought, instead of me reading it, or even worse, singing it, I want to just play you a song that I think, I've heard it in the mall, I've heard it, I can hear it at home, you know, but it's a song I've heard many times. So I want you just to listen to this song and just sort of get a feel for how music lifts us. Can you feel it? So lonely, big and mild. New life, new hope. How many got your toes tapping already? Oh, yeah. Okay. All right, that's good, that's good. Oh, man, I'd like to play the whole thing. But doesn't it get you? Doesn't it just grab you? Doesn't it make you go, man, that's good. That's good. Music can lift us. It has an incredible power in our life. And I love the lyrics in that song as well. I love how it says, "New life, new hope, new joy he brings. Would you listen to the angels sing? Glory, glory, glory to the newborn king." It's amazing. You know, hundreds of years before Jesus was born, Isaiah, he was a prophet. He was talking, he was foretelling about this coming king. And he told some pretty remarkable things about this king in advance of his arrival. And I want to just read you some of that, you know, and it really jives with this song, "New Life, New Hope, New Joy He Brings." Listen to this out of chapter 61 and verse 3 of the book of Isaiah. It says, "This king would provide for those who grieve in Zion." Zion's another name for Jerusalem, basically. "And he would bestow on them a crown of beauty instead of ashes." So back then, when they were grieving, they'd put ashes on their head to show how sad they were. "And then the oil of joy instead of mourning." When you were done grieving, you'd clean off the ashes and you'd put oil on. That was a sign to say, you know, you're back to normal. So the oil of joy instead of mourning. And then listen to this one, "a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair." And they will be called, the king has transformed these people, this coming king would transform people in such a way that this is how they'd be described. "They will be called oaks," like strong, stable, "oaks of righteousness, a planting of the Lord for the display of his splendor." So he'd make them solid and strong in him,
And then people would see them and go, whoa, they got something that they got from God. It's amazing. It's an amazing story. And you know, the one line that I keep coming back to is this one, a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. Now, there's been a lot of people facing despair. And just think of that transformation, a spirit of despair for a garment of praise. Now, what is praise? In the mid-90s, I had an experience in a church that made me sort of, it gave me a new picture of praise. And I had traveled to London, England, and I was in a church on the outskirts of the city that was a black church. So when I went there with a handful of my college buddies, we were the only white people in a church of probably about 600. And when the music started and the band began, everybody got to their feet and started to move. Like it was just a moving sea of people. And it was interesting because I grew up singing in church, so that's not unfamiliar to me. But this was different because it wasn't just, you alone sort of singing, to God or about God. It was interactive. And so they would look at each other and sing at each other. And if that wasn't enough to get you really, they say, God is good, you should trust him, whatever they're singing, he cares for you, they'd be singing stuff like that. But if you weren't getting it good enough, or if the person you're singing to was three rows down, you just point at them. So all over this big church, everybody's pointing at each other and singing at each other. You need to know the Lord is good. He cares for you. He cares about the brokenhearted. And they're just pointing at each other, and they'll turn right around and point at the people behind them. And so we're sitting there and not used to this culture, and people are turning around, looking me dead in the eyes and going, God, you should trust God. He knows, he knows your name. They're singing all these things to you. It's awesome. It was like an amazing picture of people loving God and loving each other with all their heart, their soul, their mind, their strength. It was just an amazing, amazing thing. And that's what, when I think of praise, I thought that was praise, right? They were just talking about how good God was, but they wanted to know, they wanted to make sure that people who maybe were discouraged that week or in despair, that they were trading that despair in for trusting in God and for what they could have in God. It was an amazing thing. People need that. We need that. We need that. We need environments that lift us. Whether people are singing God's truth at you or just around you, we need those kind of environments. We need to be lifted. And I get that experience here at Hillcrest Church. I get that experience. So many times I've been in this church and, the singers and musicians are leading us, and I'm just going, oh, I needed this. I didn't even know how much I needed this. I'm so glad I showed up this week. Now, it's a little different in this season. We don't get to show up as much, and most of the people who are showing up online. But even there's an encouragement that happens when we come together in whatever way we can gather, whether it's live or online. So we want to be lifted, and today we wanted this service to lift you. We hope it does. We hope it has. We hope it continues to be a lifting influence in your life. So I know right now our online family is obviously way bigger than our in-house family. And I want to just quickly say to you, if you're watching us online, maybe you're watching us with a whole bunch of kids around and you're trying to keep them corralled, bless you for doing that. We know what a real challenge that can be in our family. And we're so glad you joined us. That's awesome. I hope you're lifted through this service. And maybe there's just two of you. You're at home and you realize Christmas is going to be mostly just the two of you. Hey, I hope that God really blesses you both and you experience being lifted in this season. And if you're one that is all alone right now, you're just there by yourself, then I want to remind you that God is there with you, and we want to bless you. We want to bless you through this service, and we want you to be lifted. In fact, what we want for people is we want this whole next year, 2021, we want it to be a year of great joy, a year of great joy in people's lives. So I heard about this guy once. And a dad, and he's shopping in the grocery store, and he's got his little toddler with him. And this little guy is just screaming his head off crying, just screaming bloody murder, like he is uncontrollably crying. And so the dad is, he's got the cart, and he's pushing it along, and he's bent over, and he's just softly saying, Albert, relax. Albert, don't cry. Albert, it's going to be okay. Albert, we're going to be home soon. Albert, please be patient. Albert, Don't cry. And you know, this lady from across the aisle, she saw him and she just came right over him. She said, you know, sir, I just want to commend you. I see how you're dealing so softly with little Albert here. And he turned to her and he said, ma'am, this isn't Albert. I'm Albert. Now, if you've got kids, you know what I'm talking about, or you know what I'm talking about. But in 2020, I think all of us have been Albert at some point. You know, wouldn't you agree? At some point, you've gotten to that point where you're going, I just got to make it home. I just, you know, don't cry. Don't hurt anybody, right? I just got to get home, right? Because it's been a hard year. It's been a heavy year. And so we're doing a lot of talking ourselves down in this season. We're all Alberts in this season. So life gets heavy. What do? We try to be in environments that lift us, and that's a big part of what church is, and that's a big part of what Christmas is. It's something that can lift you. But I want to be clear about one thing tonight, in that as much as great movies or great songs or great people or great environments or church itself can lift us, the greatest lifter is God himself. The greatest lifter is God himself. Check out Psalm 3, verse 3. It says, but you, Lord, are a shield around me, my glory, and the one who lifts my head high. The one who lifts my head high. And that's what we're praying for this next year, 2021, a year of great joy, a year where you experience God being the one who lifts you high. And I'm talking about regardless of the circumstances. You know, it's one thing to say 2021 is going to be a year of great joy. Now, you might think, oh, do you know something I don't know, Steve? Do you know something about next year, about how it's going to go? And I want to report that I do not. I know nothing more than you do about next year. In fact, probably some of you know more about next year than I do. I don't know what's going to come. I don't know if it's going to get way better or way worse. I don't know any of those things. This is what I do know. It can be a year of great joy, regardless which way it goes. It can be a year of great joy for each one of us. And that's what we're going for. Regardless of our circumstances. That's how you know when you really have joy. Because it's not just meant to be something that you experience in external context. You can have a joyous context. You can be in a place where this is a lifting environment. This is lifting. Oh, I love it. But you're meant to be lifted internally as well. You're meant to have joy within you that actually can carry you and lift you, even when you're in situations that are not positive. And they're very difficult. It's supposed to be internal. Let me illustrate. I want you to imagine you're doing something that you really do love around Christmas. Let's say, for me, it'd be like, we're decorating Christmas cookies, but I can eat as many of them as I want. That's what I would like, right? You know, sometimes you decorate Christmas cookies and you can't eat them. No. I want you to imagine that you're putting sugar on them or whatever, you're doing whatever you're doing with them, but then every time you want to, you can just chow down. That's what I would like. And then there's Christmas music, so it's fun, and you're sort of dancing in the kitchen. Everybody's having fun together. You have your family. So I'm imagining an ideal environment. And it's joyful. And then your wife says, well, in my case, it would be my wife. She says, hey, come into the living room and help me decorate in the living room. I'm like, sure, yeah, we're having so much fun. This is great. And I walk in there, and she says, you know, thanks for bringing all the boxes, the Christmas boxes of decorations, up, you know, from the basement or from the garage. Or it used to be a couple years ago, I'd have to go way out into the tundra to our shed that was falling down. And that's where the Christmas decorations were. It was never very fun. But you'd get the boxes, and she says, okay, so we're gonna put up some lights, okay? So imagine you've just come from the kitchen and the cookies, and the eating, and the festivity, and you open a box, and you're gonna have more fun putting up lights. It's gonna be great. You're really excited for it. And so you reach into the box, and you pull out the lights. And your joy is gone. Because who put them back like this? This is not how you store Christmas lights. And this is gonna, and if you've ever tried to untangle this, you know this looks like it will be 1 minute, but it's not. This could be 20 minutes, it could be an hour, and you're just like, you know, it's like, what did you do tonight? I unrolled 9 feet of Christmas lights. That was my whole evening. This can really blow the joy out of your life. You know, and you might just be like, honey, I'm going back to the cookies. I don't want to face that. I don't want to untangle that. That just makes me mad or sad, and I wonder who did that. You know, I just want to, I think we're like that with our lives a lot of times. We think, man, if I've got happy stuff happening around me, I'm up. But if I have to face the way that my life is tangled and twisted and not really working like it should, I want to escape it. I want to medicate it. I want to get away from it. I don't want to have to face it. I don't want to have to go there. And so we often do avoid that. And that's just like our lives. We get into environments with all these joy, and then we come back to our real lives. Tonight, I want this place to be a lifting place, but I don't want you to go home to a tangled up life and have no joy for that environment too. So I want you to have a joyful environment, but I also want you to have something you can carry into environments that are tougher. And that's what I really want to share with you tonight. Hebrews 12 is, I'm going to read a few verses from Hebrews 12, and it's, I think these verses, I've shared them many times, but I think they're more appropriate in this year than almost any year I've ever seen. It says, at this time, it's talking about a future time, at this time his voice shook the earth, but now he's promised, once more I will shake not only the earth, but also the heavens. So a time of shaking is coming. And the words once more indicate the removing of what can be shaken, that is, created things, so that what cannot be shaken may remain. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us be thankful and so worship God acceptably with reverence and awe. Let me just unpack this for you. If there ever was a year, if there ever was a year that proved to us that anything can be shaken, I think it was this year, at least in my lifetime. Maybe if you lived longer, I know I have my mom, she grew up in the Second World War, so she probably has a greater comparable. But for me, this is the most shaky year. And people, what have we done in our lives? We've created supports, right? All these created things, right? Well, I've got my thing I can do here with my sports team. I've got this sort of connection. I've got all these things. These things are all lifting environments in my life. And suddenly, the shaking, the great shaking of 2020 happens, and these things fall away. And they are exposed. They're exposed as shakable things. You go, oh, I didn't even think that could be shakable. And did you think that, I mean, what we're experiencing this Christmas, did you ever think that would happen? That by law you would have these kind of limitations? No. So much more stuff is shakable than we really realized. And we were depending on those things. We'd built our foundation on shakable stuff. And this verse is telling us that when a time comes that everything's shaken, the key is to find out what isn't shaken. And it actually says there's only one thing. In these verses, it says, since we're receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let's be thankful. And so worship God acceptably with reverence and awe. So what is that? A kingdom that cannot be shaken? Well, it's the kind of language you find in the Bible again and again, referring to when Jesus, when you receive Jesus as your king. When you say, you know, that was how, you know, when Jesus came as a baby, they recognized, you know, the wise men, the story of the wise men seeing the star and then coming to Bethlehem. They recognized, this is a king. He's a baby now, but he's a king. He's a king. And so they worshiped. That was the appropriate response. So we're receiving, there's something to be received here that's unshakable. That's really good news. That's really good news when everything else has been shaken away. You know what? I was just reading a Gallup poll, and it was talking about the mental health of Americans. Gallup poll is usually American polling. So it had been, this is a Gallup poll on mental health that's been done for over 20 years, I think, now. And they would ask people just to self-report. How's your mental health? Excellent? Good? Fair or poor, I think, are the four answers. So basically four different answers. And most people would say good or excellent. In fact, the results every year, they'd take the good and the excellent, and they'd add it together, and they'd find out that the high water mark in the last 20 years has been 89% of people in 1 year saying, yeah, my mental health is good or excellent. And then the low water mark would be 81. So it wasn't a big variance, but it still could tell you stuff was going on. If, you know, 8% of the population suddenly dropped out of good and excellent into fair or poor, well, then you suddenly go, oh, okay, something's at work, something's happening. But in 20 years, that's the variance. Any guesses on this year? Was it 89 or 81? It was 76. This is the new low in mental health, where people are reporting. And I went through the report. It was line and line, and they really dug down into the details. Who was feeling worse? Who was feeling like their mental health had deteriorated? And it was everyone. Everyone. So they have the poor are feeling a deterioration in their mental health, and the middle class, and the rich. The rich are not immune. Okay, so that was the first thing I saw. And then I saw that it didn't matter if you're Republican, Democrat, or independent. Your mental health had still declined, on average, in the United States. And it didn't matter whether you were a boomer, a Gen X, Gen Y, or Gen Z. Mental health has declined right across the board. It didn't matter if you were male or female, or married or not. And all ethnicities that were experiencing this decline, right across the board. So I'm looking down this report, and it's showing like the minus numbers, minus this, minus this, minus this, minus this, and there's one line that stands out, and you can't miss it, because it says plus 4% increase in mental health from last year. I thought, what? Who's having an increase in mental health in this year? Whose mental health is better than it was a year ago? And it's the part of the section where they're talking about religious observance. So it says, people who never go to church, decline, like big decline. People go to church like, you know, maybe every month or something like that, big decline. People go to church every week, up 4%. I'm reading this and I'm going, wow. Now I'm not totally surprised by it, because I've read report after this. Being a pastor, you keep finding these things where you're like, this is really, like, one of the healthiest things you could do for yourself is go to church every week. It's a lifting environment. But I'm going to tell you the secret that it's not just because it's a lifting environment. I mean, that's part of it. But there's something much deeper at work there. See, what are people finding in church that they can't find in anything else? The answer is Jesus. It's definitely Jesus. Now, I know this from personal experience. I was one of those kids who got took into church every Sunday since I was a little kid and through my teen years. And I went as a young adult and all the way. So I've had a whole life of going to church. So I'll tell you the part that you might not see in a Gallup survey. It's not just that it's a lifting environment. It's because people have found Jesus. People have found Jesus along the way. So God has a promise for you at Christmas time that you can have the joy that he speaks of. Now, when you hear the story of the angels appearing, and they come to announce that Jesus is born, they don't tell everybody. They begin with the shepherds. And they pick a group of people that are probably carrying a lot of weight. The shepherds are maybe some of the more miserable, and they're in a darker place. They're actually doing the night shift. I mean, night shift is sort of normal in our culture now, but we have electric lights, right? They did the night shift when the night shift wasn't. Most people just lived by the daylight, right? There are some places in the world where you still go where everything shuts down at 6 o'clock, especially around the equator. It's like, no, there's no nightlife. Just go to bed at 6, because everybody's waking up at 6, right? 12-hour day at the equator. But this was the kind of society they lived in. So they're working through the night when very few are working as much through the night. And so they're more miserable in a darker place, and they're doing a worse job than many people are doing. And that's who the angels came to. That's who God decided to lift with this news. And what does the news sound like? Luke 2, 10 to 11 says, "But the angel said to them, 'Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord.'" Now, I want to break this down for you in different ways. It's good news. Now, why did they need good news? Well, because there's some inherent bad news we all have to face. The reality is nobody's born into a right relationship with God. We've inherited from those who've gone before us, we've inherited a natural tendency to go our own way, not to go God's way, to make our world all about ourselves, put ourselves at the center and everything else on the periphery. And you know what? This is a sickness that really hurts people. I mean, not only are we rejecting God by putting ourselves at the center, we're also hurting other people in relationship. And you know what? It's hard to get out of. It's hard to get out of selfishness on our own. And that's why God came. It was good news. See, when you think about your tangled life, or I think about my tangled life, you might have a thought that, well, I wouldn't mind having God in my life, but I would sort of rather that I got it untangled before I invite him into this. And that's not actually how it works. One of our pastors, Dave Moore, he had a really great analogy the other day. He said this. He said, you know, you can have a guy in the deepest coal mine, deep into the earth, as far from the surface as you can possibly have. And you can have a guy in the highest mountain, as high as you can go on the earth. And it doesn't matter. Neither of them can touch a star. And that's how it is with God. Sometimes people say, well, you know, I've lived a pretty good life. You know, God's just going to accept me based on that. No. The Bible tells us all have sinned. All have lived with us ourselves at the center in such a way, and we don't often even spot it. In fact, if you're single and you get married, it might show up on your radar. You know, wow, I noticed it when I got married. Wow, I didn't know how selfish I could be. I didn't know how deeply ingrained my selfishness is. And so, what's the great hope? It's not that you improve yourself so that God will accept you. It's that even if you're in the darkest coal mine, in the bottom, like I mean, in the rankings of being selfish, God has come for you. He's come to save you from that power of sin in your life, that power of selfishness in your life. He's come to break the power of that. You know what the word Christ means? The word Christ, which is like a title. We say Jesus Christ, it's like a title. But it means the one who has the power to break the yoke of bondage off of your life. So if you say, my life's too tangled. My life's too messed up. He's not asking you to get better first. He's not asking you, you know, he's not shouting down from heaven, fix yourself, then you can be okay with me. No, he came. So it's good news that will cause great joy. There's great joy in this. There's great joy. In fact, the people who began to follow Jesus started to experience this great joy. And remember, I said it's joy that isn't dependent on your circumstances. So you have people like Paul the Apostle who wrote things like, I have learned the secret to be content in all circumstances, whether I'm well-fed or got nothing to eat, whether I got lots of money or nothing at all, whether I'm super healthy or I'm just sick. He says, I've learned the secret. And the secret was relationship with God. The secret was the joy he found in that relationship with God, being forgiven by God for his sin, having the power of sin broken off his life so that it wasn't the main thing dictating his steps and that he was now following the leadership of God. He said, I'm living in a whole new world. Is my life easy? No way. My life's not easy, but do I have joy in it? Absolutely. I have great joy and contentment that is not about whether my circumstances are good. Think of Habakkuk in the Old Testament. His statement's basically, I'll paraphrase for it, basically, you got no, basically, it's a farming statement. You got no wheat in the field, you got no fruit on the vine, you got no animals in the stall. Basically, you're bankrupt as a farmer, and you might not even live. You might starve. And he goes on to say, I still have joy in the Lord. This is what people started to discover, that you could have a joy that wasn't based on your circumstances. In fact, you could face the worst circumstances in life and still retain this joy because it wasn't shakable. It was based on having Christ Jesus as King in your life. So how do we get this joy? How do we get this joy? If you want to untangle your life, well, if you want to untangle your Christmas lights, what do? You sit on the floor and you put in the work, right? But if you want to untangle your life, you invite Jesus to join you. I mean it. In your mess. In your tangle. Don't try to untangle part of it first. It's like people, you know how people clean up their houses before the house cleaner arrives? That's an unnecessary step. I know that's in us. I know that's in us. With God, that's not how it works. You just say, here I am. And he receives you as you are. No matter where you're at, he'll enter in to that place in your life and begin to work. He does want to untangle your life. He will work towards that in your life. But he's not asking you to fix it first. So it's good enough, because we can't be that, and that's not possible. So joy is found in finding your place in connection with God. You gotta know God. You gotta know God. Let me tell you a story. This is a true story. A husband and wife were fighting. It was really serious. And they had three little kids. And the wife battled with depression and anxiety. And one day, she just disappeared. And the husband started to, you know, just send her text and say, "Where are you? You're not at home. I don't know where you are. Please come home." And then he sent her more texts and emails and you know, messaged her any which way he could, because he really did not know what happened to her, where she was. And the whole day went by and nothing. So the next day, he's still messaging, and then he thinks, I got to go to the police. So he goes to the police and he says, "I guess I'm filing a missing persons report. Yeah, my wife and I didn't have everything together. We're fighting a lot, and she has, you know, depression and anxiety. But, you know, could you find my wife and see if you can find her?" Anyhow, the police say, "Sure, we'll keep our eye out for her." But they find nothing. Days go by. Dozens of texts turns into hundreds of texts. Still nothing. And so finally, the husband's, he doesn't know whether she's dead or alive or what's happened to her. He gets no response at all. He doesn't even know if she's getting these texts. He doesn't know what's going on. And so finally, he hires a private investigator. And so he says, I'm at my wit's end. I don't know what to do. Will you just make it your all-out search, the only thing you do, to see if you can find my wife?" And of course, he hires the guy and he starts. And a few days later, the private investigator finds her. So she's at some roach-infested motel in the middle of the inner city, in a little room. So the dad is shocked, but he gets the three kids, he puts them in the van, and they drive to the motel. And he nervously goes up to the door, of the door number that she's supposedly in, and he knocks on the door, and she just opens the door. And there she is, and he's standing there quiet, and she just turns around and walks into the room, and she starts to gather her clothes and some toiletries, and just starts putting things into her bag. She zips it up, and then just without a word, just walks out and goes and gets in the passenger seat of the car. So the dad is like, okay, goes and sits in the car and starts the engine, and they drive home. They don't say a word the whole way home. And then when they get home, the dad just says, "Okay, kids, just go to your rooms. Mommy and daddy are going to talk." And he goes into the kitchen, and now he's facing her, and they still have not said anything. And he just says, I don't understand it. I sent you hundreds of texts. I've been trying to reach out to you with so many different ways. And then I come and I see you at the hotel and you just came. You didn't put up a fight or anything. You just got in the car and you came with me. I just don't understand it at all. What's going on? Why did you just come so easily?" And she said, "I came because you came for me. It's because you came for me." It's the same understanding with God. He came for you. It's the message of the angels. The good news of great joy that will be for all people. That means it's for you. That Jesus came for you. And he came for me. That's the message. He came for you. He didn't send you a text message. He didn't send you a scroll. He physically came. When we sing songs like, "O come, Emmanuel," it's like saying the same thing three times. O come." And then what does Emmanuel mean? It means God with us. And so when Jesus came, it was the answer to the thirst of the human heart that was saying, I can't manage my own mess. I can't untwist my life. The things I don't want to do, I keep doing it. Who's going to have mercy on me? Who's going to have pity on me? And then he came. And it doesn't matter how disordered the mess of your life is. He just came to enter it, to forgive it, and to untwist it. And because he came, We can come to him. So I'm just saying, if you're looking at me today and saying, Steve, I'm so far from God. I'm such a mess. I've been trying to fix things on my own, but I just can't seem to get it. You need God's power to see these things change in your life. Just like if I took these lights out, ever plug in Christmas lights, what happens? For some of us, nothing. Right? There's some bulbs that are untwisted. You got to do the whole string, whatever. The reality is, we need to plug into God. It's not a case of doing more, earning more, or proving ourselves. That's not how it works with God. He had mercy on us in our condition, and he came. He entered the disordered mess that is human life, and he lived it alongside of us. Lived that perfect life, sinless life, that we could never live. And then he died that sacrificial death for us that we deserve to die, but he died on our behalf. And in doing that, he made it possible. He made it totally possible for us to be in right relationship with God. Not based on our performance or what we did, but based on what he did. So there's this incredible exchange that can happen in our lives. We come to him with our tangled, messed up life, and we offer it to him, and he just starts to untwist. And you know, we don't stand as our standing for God totally changes. The perfect obedience of Jesus is applied to our lives. It's like we never sinned and we always obeyed God. And in exchange, he takes our sin on himself on the cross and canceled any debt that we owe to God so that we can be right with him. So I want to tell you, this is the, when we read stats about people who go to church every week, how their mental health is better, I want to tell you, some percentage of that is because it's a lifting environment. But the other part of it is they met Jesus. They came to understand what Jesus is offering them. And they came to know that he's here to lead us, to forgive us, to love us. And that's a gift that we just have to receive. So if you're here today and you say, well, I want to start. I want that joy in my life. I want what people are already experiencing. I want that unshakable joy that when everything else is shaken, no matter how the next year goes, I want to live my life with great joy. I'm going to lead you in a prayer. And if it reflects where you're at, you say, yeah, that's where I'm at. Then just whisper it under your breath, right? If you confess with your mouth, if you believe in your heart and confess with your mouth, the Bible says you'll be saved. You'll be saved from your pattern of sinful. That sinful power will be broken over you. It will no longer be your master. And also you'll be forgiven for the things that you've done and have a brand new life with God. Let me lead you in prayer. Yeah. Jesus, I thank you for coming for me. Thank you that you came. And I'm ready to be where I belong with you. I'm ready to be with you. So forgive me for going my own way. I turn away from that now. I recognize that was the wrong way to live. And I turn from that. And I ask you to be the leader of my life. I ask you to be my Lord. I ask you to be the one who saves and forgives me. Be my Savior, as the angel said. Be the Christ who can put my life back together and can break off that yoke of bondage that I've been carrying. I don't want to live under that burden anymore. I believe you're the true and living God. I believe you died, you were buried, and you rose again. And today I put my faith in you. I trust in you. All these things, I just ask you to lead and guide me in your name. Amen. Yeah. I want to just say one more thing. If you've prayed that prayer today, would you reach out to us here at Hillcrest? We'd love to help you, just assist you on the way, encourage you, lift you as you go. There's a connection card on our website you can fill out. Just let us know. I made that decision today, and I embraced the gift of joy that Jesus has got for my future. All the things he's got for me, I've embraced it today.
Thank you so much for joining us this evening. Have a very Merry Christmas.